We now invite you to listen to Supreme Master Chinghai's lecture entitled Master's Pilgrimage to the Himalayas, given on July 7, 1997, during a gathering with our association members in Los Angeles, California, USA.
Supreme Master Chinghai's lectures are not a complete meditation instruction. Please do not try alone. For free of charge guidance, please visit www.godsdirectcontact.org or contact any of our centers near you.
I have just discovered one very important, important thing. That is, if you don't sleep in the evening last night, then you feel very sleepy today. Do you know that?
Yeah.
Did you sleep enough last night?
Yes.
I did. But it's okay. And today I went to the sea. What do you mean, oh? Huh? You don't know there's a beach around here? Do you go to the beach sometimes?
Yeah.
Beach swim?
No.
Too cold, huh?
Yes.
I saw a lot of people swim, you know, like today. It's so cold, I don't know how they do it. Well, I did it in the Himalaya before, but I never do it again. You know, in the Himalayas, it's the Ganges River, the most, sacred river of the Indian people. And it begins in the Himalaya, very high mountain, the place where the Ganges River first originates. It's called Gangotri, means the source of the Ganges River. And I went there. And the water just flows directly from the ice. You don't see any more river, just water running from the icy cold mountain. And that's where the water came from first. And then you can bathe in there. A lot of people go there to take a bath, in summer. And then believe it, they clean their sin. I told you already, did I not? Yeah? No? Okay, so millions of people go there every year. Some of them die in between.
Before and after. But still, people like to go there to clean their sin. And normally, they come there and just splash some water on their face. Because the water is so cold. It just came from the ice, you know. Just a little bit. Like zero degree. And the water just flowing ice. Because the sun of the summer, you know, melt the top of the snow, the top layer of the snow and of the ice. So the water will run down there, and that is how the Ganges begin. And people go there and splash the water on the face, you know, or hand and things like that, or their feet, so that they believe is their sins is clean. And I went there and did exactly the same. But then I thought, oh, then only my face and my hand are cleansed of the sin. How about the rest of my body? That won't do. So I jump in. Oh my God. Trời đất ơi, lạnh quá trời. I jump in and I have to count to five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then I have to jump out. Because then if you don't jump out after five, you never jump out again. And you will float out, you know, to the plane like this. And become one of the many. Yeah, because in India, after people die, they don't bury. Nah? Mostly they will burn the corpse, huh? Or they just throw it in the Ganges River. First they burn it and throw the ashes in the river. Any river. Because the Ganges has many, many branches too. And there are three of the source of the Ganges. One is Yamuna tree, the other is Ganga tree, the other is, never mind. Another tree somewhere. And mostly people in India, after somebody die, the living will burn them. The one who has money, their bodies will be burned by their relatives and friends until became ashes, and then they put into an urn, you know, box like this, and then they went to the water, big water like Ganges River, and throw it in. But some people don't have enough money, so they just throw it in, you know. And then after a while it becomes swollen and white, you know. So sometimes if you walk along too long, you know, along the Ganges River, because there are many roads along the Ganges River, and you walk too long and you're tired and you don't know where to rest, you just lay near the Ganges River, not too near, in water, they will rise up in the night, you know. And then take some of the body, you know, this still intact body and swollen and soft and white, you know, and make it a pillow. It's very soft. You try. Or you can meditate on it, you know. So when you go to India, there's no need cushions. Just go to Ganges, you know, the riverside, and pick any of your size or bigger size. Then just sit on it. It's pretty soft. Soft and just, you know, spongy. And then when you sit in such a corpse, you feel in samadhi, I guarantee. Because you're too frightened to move. Just stiff like this. Yeah. A lot of yogis, they do that. Nobody is afraid of death in India. They will laugh at you if you're scared of death, nah? But for them, to die is liberation. You just go from somewhere else, it's better, and you take a rest. And if you want to come back to this world again, or if it is your destiny or your mission to come back, you will just come back. Yeah. No problem. And it is so. Of course, there's some places unpleasant, but most people go to pleasant place, like astral paradise, and then come back again. No? And when you die, the body has no more problem. It won't cause any problem to anybody else. The corpse is just dead, discarded kind of material. So nobody is ever afraid of death at all. You know that? No, you don't? Okay, go to India, get a cup, sit on it and ask it, should I be afraid of you? He said, mm-mm. And then you run. Yeah, it looks very bad sometimes if you happen to see some corpse which is half decomposed and half is still there, or half is eaten by dogs or vultures, you know, and half is still hanging around there. Yeah, then it looks very ugly, huh? But when the corpse is still complete, you know, and fat and white and puffy, you know, it make a good pillow and meditation cushion. You can try. I guarantee satisfaction, money back. The rumor has it that because of so many like decomposed body in the Ganges water, that's why the water is so pure. They say the calcium, you know, from those rotten bones or something, purify the water. So actually, there's so much garbage and trash and thing go into the Ganges River. But the water is really pure. You can put it in a jar for 10 years, it won't go rotten. It's just as it is, you know. They don't have like purified system in India, and they don't have a filter to make sure the water is clean even. No, they just drink like that, straight. Some people use cloth, to filter, but some people don't. And sometimes a leprosy kind of center, you know, situated next to the Ganges river bank, on top of your river section. And people still go to the river there, And in India, sometimes they don't have sanitary system, so everything just very freely go anywhere. And sometimes you happen to encounter, you know, yesterday chapatis on the road, you know, or milk, you know, under your feet, but in different form and different smell, of course, because it's been 2-3 days old already. Has been go through some filter system. So you just have to put up with it. Sometimes, you know, you think of a Himalaya or Indian and some riverside as a very romantic, mysterious place to go to sit for meditation. When I went there the last or very last time, it was summer, and I went to the top of the Himalaya, you know where the source of mysterious story like Babaji, Yogananda, you know, teacher and all that came from. And I was dying to find a riverside spot to sit and meditate, you know, as is described in the book. You know, you have to do everything according to the book. It sounds so romantic, you know. The yogi sit next to the river, you know, on the bank of the river and all that, and forget everything, you know. Just be in bliss for a reunion with God. Oh God, I try hard. Because everywhere is, you know, 3-4 days old chapatis. And the smell is also awful, you know, just like 3 days old. You can't even find a place to sit next to the water anymore. And that was one of the holiest places in India and in the Himalaya. Because so many people go there every year, and that's why it become a little bit unholy. So sometimes the illusion and the reality don't match. We imagine a lot of things. So sometimes there are a lot of things that you don't know about the Himalaya. And sometimes a big snake, you know, as big as your body, cobra, you know, like rattlesnake, some what? And wear glasses, snake and all that. Oh, they look pretty impressive when they rise ahead at you and say hello. Hi there. I don't think you should return the greeting. Either you stay still or you run fast. Mm. Well, it's not all that bad. In my house, there's only scorpions and centipedes. It's no snakes. Snakes stay outside. But the scorpions, they are funny, you know? Maybe it's too cold or maybe they are lazy. They didn't bite me. But they did buy some neighbor. I think my neighbor scorpion are more diligent than mine. Because mine never bit me. One time I sleep. Oh, this is another story. Later, okay. Okay, so my scorpions is, you know, they sleep with me. They sleep under the couch, huh? Not that I really have a couch. It's just a very rotten four-leg kind of... Those ropes were made from the bark of the trees and all that. And then they knit them together and then hang it on the four poles, you know, like that. And it's just like a hammock. And then you throw your sleeping bag on it, zip it up and sleep. And then meanwhile, not that I have magical power, but I can see through the walls and the roof. Thousands of holes in everywhere. I call them 5,000-star hotel. And it's pretty cheap, yeah? And then the scorpion, of course, like to wander around, you know, through the halls, through the roof, and then sometimes drop on top of my sleeping bag and just stay there. And then in the morning when I wake up and say, "Ooh, what is that?" And he raise his head and say, "It's me." It's me, Scorpio. So I had to take, you know, one or two of them under the pillow or the blanket or under the table or under the chair or under the bed. Huh? Sometimes a lot, maybe 10 of them. And centipedes, you know. and take them together and put them in a jar, and then go out for a walk. And then find some big rock and take that, let them take refuge. And next day, others come again. Ah, every day I'm busy. Take care of these sentient beings. But there was fun because there's nothing much to do. That was in one of the houses, the mud houses that I stay, where they call mud houses because they use mud to make the wall. You know, they just simple, you know, tie some piece of wood or something together, and then they put and they mix them with some kind of grass, you know, and then just pass it on the wall. And then when it dry, that's what it is. And of course, you know, when it dry, there are a lot of holes will appear, you know, because it's never enough. And of course, you can fix them by go out and find some mop and fix it up. Okay, so that's thing. That's one of those houses I live. Most of the house in Himalaya like that, if you even have a house. And sometimes they also rent a veranda to you. Like that kind of house already occupied. So outside of the house there is a kemahing, veranda. Huh? 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 Garage? They don't even have any garage. Huh? Veranda, huh? Okay, you can rent the veranda as well, it's cheaper. And you take your, you put your belonging in the corner, and you hang your mosquito net there, and that's where your house is. If you don't have mosquito nest, you can rent. They will also rent you blanket, mosquito net, you know, and a warm stove, and coal you can buy. And then you can cook something for yourself. But it's not much, huh? Mostly there, I just eat raw. It's too much to carry a lot of utensil around. And when you climb very high, you can't afford. There's no car, no garage, no train, no motorcycle. I don't ever see any motorcycle climb the mountain yet, but there may be in the future. And not even bicycle. The only bus you can take is number 11. And it goes pretty slow. Especially uphill. Huh? And when you carry your sleeping bag and chapati flour and, you know, kangbei, you know, cup, steel cup, or a spoon, whatever. Everything very heavy. So the higher you go, the more stuff you throw away.
Ancient, beautiful, and mystical India. An unlimited, unending source of fascination for people from all over the globe. India is also the birthplace of many holy masters who have shared with the world the paths to spiritual illumination. Geographically, India is very vast, covering an area of 3.3 million square kilometers, making it the seventh largest country on earth. India is graced with the majestic Himalayas, the highest mountain range in the world. Often called King of the Mountains, it is revered as the home of the gods. The name is derived from Sanskrit, meaning the abode of snow. To the spiritual aspirants of millennia, the grandeur and elevation of the mountains are a constant reminder of the parallel glory and majesty of the human soul, and thus are considered to be of ultimate sacredness. In the early 1980s, profoundly moved by the ever-suffering in our world which she had witnessed since the time of her childhood, Supreme Master Chinghai made a selfless and momentous decision to forsake the comfort of her personal life. Supreme Master Chinghai's earnest quest for truth and enlightenment for the benefit of all beings culminated in her courageous journey in various parts of India and eventually the divine Himalayas. We now invite you to listen to Supreme Master Chinghai's lecture entitled Master's Pilgrimage to the Himalayas, given on July 7, 1997, during a gathering with our association members in Los Angeles, California, USA.
Supreme Master Qinghai's lectures are not a complete meditation instruction. Please do not try alone. For free of charge guidance, please visit www.godsdirectcontact.org or contact any of our centers near you.
When I started my journey, I took a lot of things, you know, I would need that, I would need this, I would need this umbrella, 3-4 spoon, 2 chopsticks for different size, you know, and 2 cups and 2 dishes and all stainless steel, you know, and all that. And books even, you know, and maps, yeah, and binoculars and glasses and everything. Wow, complete, you know, like a real explorer. Yeah. And but every step I go, I have to drop one thing. Wow, you had no idea how heavy the sleeping bag even can become. When it's damp, you know, and raining a little, snowing a little, and the sleeping bag just suck in all this, and it become heavier and heavier, and my feet also became heavier, because it's a sports shoe that I wear. I have not been in Himalaya before, I thought sports shoe would do. But sports shoe, you know, all the water came inside. And the snow also sneak in, because it's warmer there, you know. And I take refuge in my shoes. And then after I walk for many miles, the feet became very big and heavy as well, you know, and you walk like this. when you have a place to rest, then you have to take all your shoes out, wring your socks, and hang it on some stove somewhere, or wash them. And they wear them again next morning. But most of the time, they don't have time to dry so fast. They don't have dryer in the Himalaya. And in the morning, sometimes we have to go very early to go together with the group, huh? Yeah. And so you have to hurry. So most of the time, I wear also damp clothes. Very damp. I have only 2 pairs of clothes, so I get 1 wash and 1 wear. But sometimes both of them look like washed because it's all in the rain, you know. So I have a choice either to wear that one, you know, soaking in the rain, or to wear the other one was soaked in the stream water. It's both the same. Sometimes they don't have time to dry. So, but after you walk for a while, you know, it dry by wind and air and your temperature body. It can dry, because if you walk, your temperature rise up, you became hot. And most of the times I walk. Sometimes in the very rare region, they have horses for rent. And they have, they call laborer who carry you behind, in the back, or 4 laborers to carry a seat and chair kind, and you sit in the middle. But be careful, because it's very slippery. Sometimes they throw the customer, you know, down. And 4 of them also crawling, you know, and they 5 crawl together. And the chair became pieces, you know. It's very dangerous sometimes. That's why people don't often go there. And if they go there and they came back in 1 piece, they think they're very lucky. Sometimes 1 piece is in the Himalaya, another piece flow down the ocean. And another piece hang on the tree somewhere, yeah, because it's dangerous. If you just walk not carefully and slip, you know, 1 step, and you became like sometime, you know, dust, because so high, you become for different pieces. A lot of people die every year going on pilgrim. Okay, let's go back to the scorpion stuff. Another time when I stay also in near the Himalaya, another place called Rishikesh, they also rent this kind of mud houses. Because the house inside is stuffy, you know, they don't make a very big deal, like big window with screen door and all that. So most of the time I climb up the roof and sleep. Yeah. And after a while, many other people, neighbor, you know, the pilgrims like me, or sometimes Westerner, they go there and meditate. Because there are a lot of ashram around there. You know, one of the master, very famous, this master from the Beatles, you know, Transcendental Meditation. yogis, he originate from there too. That place called Rishikesh. A lot of masters, when they are in different times to meditate, I also stay there for 2 months and meditate sometimes. And so I went to the roof to sleep. And you know, most often the scorpion come up to the roof like me, do yoga exercise and then meditate like big deal, and then and in the morning get up, you know, with the sun, exercise and meditate for a while and then go down. But we don't have a staircase, eh? You have to kind of climb the wall with your nails. Because the wall is mud anyhow, and there's some hole in there. You just put your toe in there, or you put your finger in there, and then you just find your way up. It's okay. I always found my way up. Okay, now let's go to stop. Did I tell you about my ex-husband when he went there and meet me? Oh, really? Okay, hang on. Don't be too excited, make trouble for me, I forget. Okay, at that time, when I was in that place called Rishikesh, did I tell you the neighbor was beaten black and blue? No, okay, next to me, okay, let's go fast because it's painful. Oh, she was beaten, so swollen everywhere. And I had to go to the hospital, it was so poisonous. But they didn't bite me. But I found one, you know, next to my pillow. In the morning, he just lay there like dead. And I say, "Hi there, are you alive or dead?" And he moves his whisker, you know, to let me know, don't touch me. I said, no, I just said hello, okay. And then, okay, so that's the place, huh? Okay, so I just tell you the story. At that time, I was about maybe a year or something already in the Himalaya. I didn't see my ex-husband then, the doctor. Huh? I just called the doctor. So what happened is, I stayed there for a while. And then my so-called husband, ex, or last, or never seen again. he went there to meet me. But he didn't know I was there. I also didn't know he was coming. I was in Delhi before, and in other region, and stay in different ashram, you know, with different masters and different groups, and just to learn here and there and checking out everything. And then I was tired of all the groups and the ashram politics, so I went alone. I went to different places to meditate, and Rishikesh was not the first place, and it's not the only place. But this is basically where things take place. So, and then I stayed there for 2 months. And then my ex-husband, he had holiday or something, or he missed me somehow. He went to India to find me, and he went to Delhi, the ashram that he knew that I was there before. So he went there, but he didn't find me. So he hang around. Nobody know where I went. He hang around and tried to find somebody who knows me. So anyhow, and meanwhile, he was miserable, and they tried to tell him that, you should not worry about your wife, you should worry about your soul, you know. What's that? So, and at that time, he already knew that I was in Rishikesh, yeah? So he said to them, my soul is in Rishikesh. So the next day, he packed, you know, and he just have a knapsack, you know, backpack. Yeah, and then he went there to see me. But talk about Rishikesh, it's also big, you know. It's not just like our meditation center here. It's a city, you know, a small city. So many ashrams, so many things going on. So many people all the time. But he went to my room and found me. Actually, I wasn't in my room. I was on top of another mountain where there was a spring water coming out, and I was washing my clothes, yeah, and taking a morning bath. Sometimes I go to the Ganges River and take bath there, but sometimes I took bath next to the stream near my home, my rented room. Okay, but another story took place before that, okay. Meanwhile, before my ex-husband came, there was another friend who came. When I stayed in one ashram in Delhi, he was there too. And he was kind of famous because he's Canadian Chinese, the one and only in the group of Indian or Western people. And I'm also one and only kind of Asian over there. So he and I were both very famous. I was famous because I worked for the ashram and they named me Smiling Step because they say every step I go, I smile. Yeah. So that's, I never saw if I smile or not. I didn't possess a mirror there. But I was very beloved. And sometimes people even bow to me, you know. They prostrate in front of me and I scared. I was so scared. Those with long beard and big turban, you know, about 70 years old, it would fit enough to be my grandmaster. Yeah, sometimes they just prostrate to me. I don't understand anything. Anyhow, that was by the way. Okay? And he was famous there, and I also knew him because he brought there the trend like survival into 24 centuries, you know, things like that. With the raw food, you know, sprouts and wheat germs. So everybody in that ashram, because they have nothing to do, they follow him. And he was a kind of, you know, survival guru, you know. And then we grow wheat germs on top of our bath tower and grow sprout in front of our, you know, window and on top of our washing sink, thing like that. So he was famous for a while. Nah? And when I was there for a while, he went there also. He went there and then he somehow found me. And he saw me, huh? And then he asked me, oh, this is a nice room. Actually very cheap, just a mud house, you know, square like this, a top, no window, no door, you know. Well, you can have a door, but, you know, look like no door at all. Quack, 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 quack. It's wood, and then you have to push with all your might. And then when you open it, bang, sometimes it bang on your head, you know. It's very difficult. So he likes it, because in such a places, you know, to find a private room like that is heaven. You can stay in any ashram there if you want, free of charge. But you can only stay 3 days in each. That's the rule. Because they don't want you to stay there forever and be attached to the ashram. So they're very hospitable, but 3 days only, and then you move. And then you keep moving all the time. It's very tiring. So got a room like that, and then he was very interested. He asked me whether he can rent one himself. I said, oh, not at the moment, not that I know of, but 3 more days, you have one next door to me. Huh? So if you want to wait, or you can come back again. He said, oh, I don't have anywhere to go, I don't know how to go around here. First day, I said, okay, then stay here in my room. Yeah? I don't sleep here anyhow. I sleep on the roof every day, and you go. And so you sleep here, you know. Actually, in the ashram before, we sometimes sleep together, not in one bed, Nama, in one room. Sometimes ashram, they make very big room, you know, and then you sleep just like in Maori. It's okay, no problem. We don't mind. Huh? So anyhow, we already knew each other, and I didn't share room with him, but sometimes we sleep outside together, a lot of people together, you know, or we went away with the teacher. Huh? Then we just have to sleep anywhere that there is a corner to lay your head on. Or sometimes you cannot. Like sometimes 6 months on stretch, I have to sit. I don't have a place to even lay down. So I have a chair, like folding chair, like you, like on the beach chair, nah? I take it with me. And one of a small suitcase. So in the evening, I just open it and sit on the chair and put my leg on my suitcase. And how I sleep for 6 months. And in the daytime, sometimes I fold it, you know, sometimes I don't. Fold is better. Now I stay in a corner. You know, like on the roof of any house, they sometimes build a little bit extra higher wall on the roof, huh? And then the corner is like this, huh? So I sit in one corner and I put my blanket on top of that corner, and that's where my house was. Every day. It's just pretty hot there, you know. In summer, it can be 40 degrees Celsius. But I have no place to go, because sometimes the ashram is overflowed with people. So I prefer to stay alone, you know. Even one corner alone is better than together with hundreds of others. So okay, I stay there. In the daytime, I cover with a blanket. In the nighttime, I just sleep under the stars and sitting, you know. Very, very simple. So when it rains, I don't have much to even move. I just take the chair and the luggage, poof, go into under the veranda roof. I sleep all day and all night there. You know, it's my quarter. I don't have anywhere else to move my stuff inside the house. Everywhere, the cool place, the safe place are all occupied. Even on the floor, everywhere. You know, sometimes like in Maoli, huh? Or anywhere that you go, like hotel, and then you sleep on the floor. Every corner you occupy. So that's the place where I put my stuff all day, all night, for 6 months. And then, so it's okay, we don't mind, you know, man, woman at that time. Just okay, just a friend. So it's okay, stay here in my room. You know, I can put your stuff here and sleep in this bed. I sleep on the roof anyhow. In the daytime, I'm almost not here because I go out to the Ganges River, swim, take a bath, wash my clothes there, and then put them on the rock to dry. Meanwhile, I hide myself in some of the cave, you know, on the Ganges River side, and I meditate. And then a few hours later, my clothes dry, and I put them back on again. And then I go out shopping. Buy some exciting thing like chapatis and peanut butters, yeah, and cucumber, yeah. Most of my meal are like that. Or else I buy flour and make chapati myself in the evening. In the evening, I make it myself. This is very simple. You buy flour, some salt in it, huh? And then you just have a plate, you know, aluminium plate or dish, you know, a little bit high like this, so you can even cook soup and tea in it, and you can make chapati on top of it. Huh? So I just roll the flour together, you know, the way I teach you. And then put on that, and then turn over, and then eat with peanut butter. That's very nice. I live very simple life because at that time I didn't have much money. I didn't ask for my ex-husband, and I didn't want to borrow from anybody. I just stretch, you know, my money as much as possible. Very simple life. So I said to him, you can use my room until you have next room. Huh? I don't sleep here, and daytime I'm gone, and nighttime I sleep on the roof. So, okay, he put his stuff there, very grateful, and then go around, go somewhere else. And in the evening, he came back and sleep on top of the roof. And meanwhile, he found his girlfriend, or I don't know, or the girlfriend just found him, or any girlfriend, I don't know. And then they nestled together next to me, and that's okay with me, all right. And then the next morning, probably my ex-husband came, okay? It's also okay with me. Yeah, it's okay with me. But then he found me, and then he wanted to speak to me, and he wanted to take me around, and he wanted me to be with him. It's okay with me too. But I said to him, well, this is the last day of my 7 days retreat in the middle of the Ganges River. So would you please wait for me until the evening, and I come back? Huh? Because in the middle of the Ganges River over there, there is a place that's just like an island. But in the nighttime, you don't see it because the water will cover it. Or cover nearly, you can't have access to it. Nighttime cannot go. At daytime, you can go. You go when the sun rises and you come back when the sun sets. Then the water is still not so high. You still can see the rock and you can walk over back to your home. But if it's a little later, the water will be too high, you can't walk. And there's no even boat to bring you from that small island in the middle back to the river bank. So I went there every day to meditate because there was a very famous master who lived opposite the bank, you know, next to the island. Yeah? And he told me I should go there and meditate in that cave for 7 days and then you feel good, you know, he told me. I said, okay, why not? I have nothing else to do. Because his disciples always go there and do retreat in the daytime. And nighttime she has to come back because it's dangerous to stay there. Sometimes the water come very high and cover the caves, you know, you can't stay there. So I went there every day and meditate, and that was the last day of my 7 day retreat that I promised the teacher. And then my husband came. So I said, okay, stay here, wait, huh? I come back. I tell him I come back about 6 o'clock in the evening. At 5 o'clock the sun set and I walk out, and then I walk around, and then there is a boat to take me back to the other side, and I walk for a while, and then about 6 o'clock, fine, huh? But that day, I couldn't go by boat. There was so much wind and rain, you know, the Ganges water became like an ocean. So much waves, so no boats coming. So I wait for one, I know it's no boat, so I had to turn around and walk many miles upstream where there will be a bridge, you know, hanging bridge, and then I can cross over there and then run back along the riverside and go back to my mountain up there. So that take longer time. It's about 7 o'clock or more when I reach my place. But my husband already gone. Yeah. And they told me, just left. And I don't know what's going on. So I found my friend, you know, the raw food survival into 24th century. So I say, where is my husband? You know? At that time, he was still my husband. So it's okay. He said, oh, he just gone. He said, how he gone? I told him to wait for me here. He said, I don't know. He just gone. And I say, what's this? Because I recognize it was a movie camera that was belonged to me before I left him. It was given to me by my fiancé, you know, the other one, that I did not marry. Also, not the doctor. It's a long story. Forget it. I was chased by a couple of doctors, so, but forget it. Just the main one, enough for you. Anyhow, that one is very rich, you know. The one that I did not marry, very, very rich. Ooh. He had a big box full of jewelry, you know, and thick. He said, that belonged to you. Now I have even more. So, that's another story, okay? Okay. He managed to engage, but that's it. No more. Okay, and then I said, what was that? He said, oh, he gave me this movie's camera. I said, why he gave you this camera? It used to belong to me. He didn't say anything, just left. Said, no, he just gave me the camera. I said, now it belongs to you, and then he just left. I said, it's funny. It's really funny. Is there anything else you say to him? He said, no, not really. We just talk, and then your husband asked me, where do I stay? I say, I stay here. In your room. And sleep in your bed. I said, oh, that's it. That's it. Oh, I was so mad at him. He said, why? It's the truth. Of course, but the truth is not true. Huh? It sounds as if I live with him and we sleep together. And that's why my husband left. I guess, huh? I guess. That's why he threw that camera to him and then left, because that belonged to me. He probably bring it for me. But then he thought, because now I live with that guy together, so that camera belonged to him too. Because I belong to him. Oh, okay. Oh, my God. I said, no. This is bad, you know? And I was so mad and panicked, and the guy didn't know anything. Said, oh, she changed. It's strange. And then I run, you know. I run after him. I run to the bus stop, find him. But then he's gone. When I arrive, he's just gone, a few minutes ago. Just like he left and I come. Just like the movies, you know. Just like those sad romantic movies. Oh, I asked them, do you see, you know, my husband just left here anywhere? So who is your husband? I said, the one with bird like this, German, tall, you know, handsome. I said, oh, yeah. He just left, you know, which bus long ago. And I said, is there any other bus now? I said, no, last one, gone. It's late. I said, oh. So because I chased him with a horse car. It takes a long time. In India, you have horse car. One horse carry about 10 person. And I ran the whole car. Still couldn't chase after him. He just left. Okay. I don't mind if he misunderstands me, you know, but he's not supposed to be. He just came first time to see me. I didn't want him to get hurt like this. Since he came already, I don't want him to have just a bad souvenir to bring home. He came such a long way and we didn't see each other for a year. You know, and I don't want him to feel so bad, yeah? Suppose he felt bad, otherwise he wouldn't have throw the camera there and go without saying one word to me and without written even a note to say why. So I didn't go there for that purpose, you know, and he misunderstood. So next day I went to the post office and tried to call him, to call Delhi from there. It's like you contact the moon or Mars, you know. Just hello, hello, and then poop, cut. And before you can even say hello, you have to wait half a day to get the line. There's only one post office, and there's a kind of, you know, old-fashioned kind of communication. Because the mountain is Himalaya, there's no such convenient, you know, walkie-talkie mobile phone like we have. So I wait half a day just to say hello, and then it cut. And then I wait another few hours again just to say another hello. And then the other guy don't understand anything about English. I say, get somebody talk English. Get somebody English. I say, English, English? No, no, sorry, bang. Okay, so next, the third time, I wait another 4 hours to get through. And then I asked an Indian guy, you know, who spoke English in the post office. Luckily, I go, please tell him I want to talk to somebody who speaks English over there, and don't hang me up again. Gotta take me a whole day to say hello. You know, so, okay, finally, I got through the message. You know, my husband, is he still there? Because he went, I guess he went back there. I don't know where he went. I guess he went back there because the friend said he wanted to go back to Germany. Why? He just came there. He wanted to stay there for 2 weeks holiday, and then he came, don't meet me, and then go back for Germany. So that means he's very sad, you know. So I say, please go and find my husband. I say, who's your husband? We have 1,000 around here with beard and with beard and blue eyes and, you know, blonde hair and tall and handsome. So I say, no, my husband, so-and-so name, please find him. And then he said, no, no, we don't know. So I say, okay, so please tell him that, you know, I call, you know, if he comes, such and such name. He said, okay, okay. But then I wasn't sure the man understands, so I give a kind of a telegraph. Huh? But I didn't even know that he would receive it. I say, you misunderstood. Please come back immediately. Huh? So and I left it there, but I had no hope that he will receive. And I waited and waited and waited. I don't see any reply. A few days later, I left. You know, I went to further higher region to go to visit those, you know, like Ganges tree, where the source of the Ganges river is. So I went up there and very high mountain. And I did say, I go where? You know, but to just random people over in around that area. Then my husband did come back. And then he did ask the people there and chase after me up to the place where I was. I was in a midway only, and then I stay in a hotel, you know, before I go further. At that time, in that place, you still have a hotel, if you can call that a hotel at all. But at least you have a room with four walls, you know, like in a prison, you have a cell like that, solitary cell, yeah. And that's enough, because at least it keeps you solitary from the mosquitoes. Yeah? You hang your mosquito net there, between the four walls, on top of the nails that you nail on the wall, and then that's it. You just jump in from the door, and then you're in the mosquito nest, and in the four walls. And it's cheap, you know, it's not expensive, I can't afford it too much. But when I went there to ask for a room, the person at the registration desk asked me, you can't stay alone. We have a husband. So I had to say, oh, my husband, yes, I have one. He's coming soon. he's coming in the afternoon. I just say like that, you know, at random. But really, he did come in the afternoon. Afterward, yeah. Then so what happened? I was on the street buying some fruit. I'm sure I told you all this story. Yeah, maybe in Chinese, maybe in German. Okay, I was planning to write a book, a story of my life, and become a bestseller. There's so many things I cannot even tell you. This is one of those stories, you know. Okay, so I was buying fruit, you know. I booked the hotel, okay, put everything there, locked my room, and then went out, buy some fruit. I was just choosing some mango, you know. And then suddenly, there were two big hands behind me, cover my face like this. And I was struggling to get free. And there was a voice, very familiar, said, "Happy birthday." And I turned around, there he was, my husband. We had the same birthday. Yeah. So I said, "Okay, happy birthday to you." And so that night he stayed with me there, and then we traveled together up there. I didn't have to explain anymore, because he know I'm alone there. Yeah, and he never asked about the guy with the camera. He probably knew too. When he went there already, probably the guy explained to him that he just borrowed my room. Meanwhile, he had already a room next door, no? And then with his girlfriend. So probably he went there, then everything is clear. The truth always comes out. Huh? I didn't even have to say anything anymore, because when he found me in the Himalaya alone like that, you know, in a small room alone, then he knows. Okay. And then he was very happy, you know, that I let him travel with him and then walk together to many different places. I show him the Himalaya that I know through the maps. And many of the legends, you know, the stories, the mysticism concerning those places. And he was fascinated, yeah. But he was a non-believer, you know. He said, "I will not be able to marry you in the church." That was before, you know, before we married. I said, "I don't mind, marry anywhere." And also, he's not prayed for when he died. I said, "Okay, never mind. I call all my Buddhist teacher come pray for you." He was a doctor, but then he continued to study and research more in his subject so that he can be better doctor, you know. So he had money. We live on well, but not very rich. It's okay. Because he also was just graduate not long ago, and he has to do internship and apprenticeship, yeah, for 2-3 years without not much pay. And also I have buy a house and all that, you know, so I understood. I never demand him anything. He give me what he can, yeah? And always unasked. Very generous husband, very considerate. I never complain about him, never, nothing. Oh, where were we? Happy birthday, okay, fine. That's it, that's where he found me, you know. It's funny how he found me just like that. No? Always. He always find me wherever he wanted. Before that, he went all over to many post office, you know, before the Rishikesh, no? Before that, the first time, he went everywhere. I said, "How you find me in Rishikesh?" He said, "Oh, he went to every post office, every bank, and asked whether such and such small Asian lady come here get money or post letter or anything like that or not." He traced me in every way he can, you know. Traced me into the ashram where I just left. I left in 3-4 ashram, and he chased them all up to there, but then I just left. Just like in the movies, I told you. He came and I just left before that, just a few minutes or maybe last night, something like that. And then he traced to the last place where he met me, at the spring water. Nah? Okay, now. So we went together everywhere like that and came back. Later on, he had to go home, and I continue my search for spiritual wisdom in India. At that time I already had some, but I thought I still need some more, you know, in case. In case, and so I continue a lot. So that was it. Sometimes I want to remember, just to remind me that sometimes people can be very wrongly accused, or wrongly judged by just outer action, by just simply the so-called facts, but it's not the truth. Yeah. If that guy just say a few words more, would have saved my husband tickets and time and agony that he had to go through for 4 or 5 days. He still loved me at that time, you know, and he expected me to sit cross-legged and somewhere, you know, like a holy person, not to run around with a guy, you know, and survival up to the 24th century with him. So I didn't want to hurt him, you know, he was very hurt, that's why he left immediately. Don't say even one word, don't even say goodbye, nothing. He was a gentleman, you see, he didn't want to trouble my new relationship. Thanks a lot. I didn't need it. That guy, he knows he's my husband. Why he say, I live here, I sleep here. You know, he could have said, okay, she lend me her room, you know, but we are not boyfriend, girlfriend. Then I would be more grateful instead of being mad at him later. And I was mad at him and he was surprised. Oh, you changed. Because I have never been mad before during all this time in the ashram or anywhere else, and everybody knows. I was a smiling angel, you know. And I had no reason to be mad at anybody. And he said, oh, you changed. What would you say in my case? Huh? What would you say?
Same.
Yeah, same, huh? Or maybe more, huh? Maybe say it with fingers. I had to do that sometimes too. During my pilgrimage journey sometimes, because some guys, they are very rude. You know, in India, a woman don't walk alone, don't go out alone, don't stay alone overnight anywhere, because then you will be looked down upon as not good, taken advantage of all the time. So of course I have to go everywhere alone. I couldn't find anyone to go with me. My husband didn't want to come with me. I didn't have any friend who has the same idea that I had at that time. So how I not go alone, huh? So I go alone everywhere. I mean, sometimes, you know, people come and make trouble for me, you know. Okay, it's okay, just talk, and then I say, okay, I don't want it, go away. But during my meditation, and go disturb me and touch my face and all this, you know. After I have so much trouble with men, you know, I put on my monk's robe. First I thought I don't want to wear it because it's too eye-catching, you know. It's very yellow, you know. It's Tibetan, red and all that. And sometimes Indian monk's robe. I was ordered into two traditions, Indian and Tibetan. And I have both of the robes set, and that's all I carry with me. Besides my two, that was after I have more transportation. And I have one set Tibetan, one set of Indian, and one set of the white. I left one in another place. I had two before, a white, like pyjama, like tunic, yeah, that I went to Himalaya with. There was only two, but after I was ordained, I have two more. So I wear them alternatively, yeah, to let people know that I'm a nun, huh? And even if I travel alone, he don't mess about with me, so leave me alone. But then everybody want to come and take me home, you know, to worship and to offer. In India, they respect monks and nuns so much. They call them saint. Yeah, they call you Babaji, Maharaji, Mahatmachi, Matachi. And they want to bring me home to feed me, clothe me, give me bath, give me room, things like that. Because these people are renunciate people. I have to always refuse, you know. Because I don't like to be worshipped. I just go around and I'm just an ordinary person. But that's okay, also fine. And one time I went into a very big camping season, camping place. That was in Hariwar. Hariwar means the gate of heaven. It's one of the very big, famous, important, holy pilgrim place in India. And every 12 years, you know, they have a Kumbh Mela. The Kumbh Mela means a gathering of all the saints and seers and sages in India. It doesn't matter where the person stay, where the monks or the seer or the yogis, you know, the saint and the sage is the one who can see things, future and all that, one who can see psychically all that, or the one who already attained enlightenment and all that, or one who had not attained enlightenment and all that, sometimes they hide themselves in caves in mountain remote. But at that time of Kumbh Mela, every 12 years they would gather in that place together. And people would come in millions to prepare hundreds of thousands of tens, you know, free of charge, for these monks and also for the pilgrims, whoever like to overnight there. Of course, never enough. But still, they reserved one tent for me when I just passed by, and I said, could I sleep somewhere? And they lead me to one very big tent, as big as this, you know, front place quarter together for me. This is too big for me. And then later, the monk and other people want to come in and sleep with me, you know, but I'm not used to it. They sleep so near, you know, and sometimes they want to hug you and all that. I said, I'm ticklish, you know, cannot do that. So I run out and went to another tent. I think that monk was a little funny. I went to another tent where I sleep with more people. I feel safer, but that is a very full tent already, you know, very full, very full. And I sleep on edge of the tent, and with all the smelling feet and, you know, kicking around and slapping around hands all the time. And I could hardly sleep. So finally, I woke up and went out, you know. And then that monk chased after me. He said, go back, sleep in that big tent. I said, no, I don't want it, thank you. He said, no, you have to go back. I said, no, I don't have to. And he said, no, you must. If you don't go back, I say, you're stealing something. I said, come on. And he still tried to force me there, you know. So I just pretend that I go there. And then after I see him, you know, just walk around. And then I go through the back, you know, under the tent. I crawl under the tent and go through the back and then run away. I even had to protect myself from monk. Can you believe that? Alone is very dangerous. So be careful, huh? He forced me there, so he said, I will steal something so that you have to stay. Can you believe that? Maybe he just wanted to protect me, you know, because he said it's dangerous out there to go alone, and I don't know it, but I say it can't be more dangerous than this. I thought it couldn't be more dangerous. I was alone, and that man was so strong. I don't know if he's a real monk or not, even if he wear monk's robe, you know. Anybody can wear monk's robe in India if you want to. And if you grow a bear as well, wow, you have everything you want. Because you're holy. People worship the monk's robe and the bear, you know? Really, I tell you, if you're fed up, you just go to India, grow a bear. And a mustache, yeah, as well, together. And let it grow as long as possible. And to be sure, you dye it in white. Huh? And then you sit next to the Ganges River, just sit there, do nothing. And then in front of you, like magic, will appear fruit, chapatis, yeah, curry, anything you want. And sometimes all the beautiful girls are prostrating in front of you, the holy sage. Really, if you have a bear, people think you're holy. Luckily, I didn't have one. Even I tried to grow her, I can't. Oh, I said to myself, oh, forget the sainthood. Who need it? That's true, huh? Well, there's a joke, but it's not too far from the truth. So when you go to India, even though the climate is so hot and sticky sometimes, you wonder why all the men grow long bare, you know? Okay, that's just by the way, huh? Where were we? Oh yeah, I sneak out of the tent and run away. I know where he was, so I sneak where he cannot find me. You know, I went very far away and then return back, go back to the gate. And I try to find a very quiet corner to meditate. And there are some, you know, a corner from the house or tent here and there, but never quiet. How can you find a quiet corner when you're in the middle of millions of people? And they talk all day, all night, and they walk all day, all night, and the dust are flying all over like cloud, 24 hours a day. And I wasn't used to it. But it was so tempting, you know. After you reach Yogananda and Himalaya master, and you know, a thing like that, huh? The living master, all that. Kumbh Mela is a rare thing. Because you don't just stay there 12 years just to see one. Just happened that year happened. And I was very lucky in that year also, the Kumbh Mela, and many very rare masters that I found. Yeah, some live a very long year, 200 years, 300 years, 250 years, everything, a lot. And that year also, the Dalai Lama also gave a very rare kind of teaching. There was a couple, you know, the Western couple, who happened to find I'm very attractive as a babysitter, so they throw their baby at me all this time. And the baby plucked my nose, fiddled my ears, you know, and pull my clothes, you know. So I was very busy buttoning all the time and keeping away from his finger that poked into my nose at the wrong time, and I achum all the time. And he squeezed in my ears and then kissed me with his wet lips and, you know, scratched my face, everything, and then screaming and talked to me in all kind of language I didn't know. So I never had a chance to hear one word what the Dalai Lama had to say. You know, not to talk about translation or anything like that. And I could not even move because I was right in the front, next to the holy people. And I'm supposed to be holy with a monk robe and that. I can't even complain. I can't even move. And the baby keep on for 3 hours long. And I said, oh, well, my, never mind. If the other couple has enlightenment, I probably have some merit as well as a babysitter. And they were so devoted and so attentive to the Dalai Lama, and they seemed to completely forget that they even have a baby. And they forgot me and the baby all together. Because it's a rare chance that the Dalai Lama, you know, the holy king of Tibet, gives such kind of initiation. It's supposed to make you become Buddha either in 4 lifetimes or in 16 lifetimes. So you can wait. No? And the initiation is very complicated. So first of all, it's not in Delhi, okay? It's not in Bombay, next to the airport or first class hotel, anything like that. It's in the middle of nowhere. It's in the mountain, very high mountain, and a barren mountain as that. It's like a desert mountain. And people who live there, those Tibetan nuns and monks or residents, they dig caves into the mountain and live there. But they were fabulous place. In the evening, I saw all the mountain turn into silver and gold. And all the sky would glitter, you know. And I kept telling people, my God, what a wonderful place. It's all gold and silver. And they say, where? And I say, here, the mountain. And they say, no, the mountain is gray. It's not silver. I say, no, it's glittering. Nobody see anything the way I saw. And I thought, it's like that. I can't believe what they don't believe, you know. I can't believe because it's so obvious that the mountain is glittering like silver and gold, and the sky glittering with all kind of light, you know. I said, yeah, here, everywhere. And they look everywhere, but nobody see. And I was beginning to wonder whether they are crazy or I am crazy. But I think my craziness is nicer because it's colorful and glittering. So it's okay. Okay, so just, you know, we slowly go to that, huh? And then so the Dalai Lama had to travel from Dharamsala, is where his abode is, you know, he has a kind of palace there, huh? Very far away from that place. And the Dalai Lama is okay because he has transportation. The army will help him with a jeep, yeah, and all that. And all his subordinates and entourage will go together with him. They went there 10 days before the initiation. First, he has to purify himself by initiating himself. I don't know how that done, but then he put some kind of flower, you know, white flower, like a band of white dry flower on top of his head like this. Now you have a headband, and then that's a kind of white flower, but dry. Then he had to sit on top of grass kind of seat prepared for him. And then all the monks around him in a glass house. 10 days, 10 nights, they have to recite mantras, sutras, and mudras. Mudra means you do the gesture by hand like this, different gesture. Yeah, when you are reciting the mantra and the sutra, you do the mudras together. That's all kind of complicated. And sometimes they also put the gong and all that. It's very beautiful also, huh? Very systematic, very rhythmatic, and very holy kind. Huh? The chanting is kind of, you know, deep and throaty tone, you know. And then you feel, oh, you feel airy, you know. Even though you don't know what it is, but you feel impressed and airy and very holy indeed, you know. You feel awesome, huh? Respectful, huh? And you became also very aware of something beyond yourself, beyond this ordinary life. Because the mountain and the place alone also impress you. Out of middle of nowhere, only mountain, 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 no residence. But then you see some holes in the wall, you know, in the mountain wall, and the nuns and monks appear there with colorful dresses, you know, and they wear beautiful hat like the Russian one, you know. Oh, the nuns, they were beautiful. Because they wear the hat, they cover their head, and they look so dignified. And the color of the dress they wear, mostly bukkan color. And then they wrap some yellow kind of outfit on it, a piece of chasa. Look like blanket, but it's packed together 100 pieces, you know. Quilt, yeah. And they wrap around their shoulder, look real holy and ancient. Nah? And then, out of middle of nowhere like that, 10,000 of people came and walk around all day making a lot of dust. Because there they don't have cement, they don't have paved road, they don't have stone paved road, nothing, just dirt. Dusty. Because the mountain is also bare. Because they cut whatever grass and tree they can find to burn, to cook. So the mountain has nothing at all. But it glow like silver and gold in the night, in my eyes. Huh? Other people's eyes, it's also dirt and gray and nothing. They told me it's cold, it's nothing. I said, okay, fine. All right, then the Dalai Lama had to do like that for 10 days, purify himself and the monks together before he give initiation for these people. So they were very, very kind of solemn kind of occasion. It's not like just a walk-through initiation. But you're supposed to, when you dream, you know, when you go to sleep at night, they tell you how to dream. You know, you must dream of something. And if you dream of monks or king, then it's supposed to be auspicious. Then you become Buddha very soon. I don't know how soon, but it's supposed to be very soon. You just have to believe it. And if you happen to dream about devil, a woman and all that, then it's no good. Yeah, so I was trying very hard to dream of the monks, but I haven't seen any that come to my dream. I meditated hard and then I slept, but nothing came. Except the silver and gold mountain and the glittering sky with light, I don't see nothing more. But I saw that before everything, before initiation. I was busy, you know, with the pokey nose baby and with his napkins and his wet, slimy lips, you know, kissing me and all that, and tried to talk to me all the time. I can't hear nothing except his baby blah blah. No. So I don't consider I was entitled to be a Buddha very soon, even if I saw some monks in my dream. And okay, that was it. So a lot of people went there for initiation. A lot of, he has many Western disciples who come all over the place to see him, especially in such occasion. And before you get there, you had to walk sometime many ten of miles because there's no car. You have to walk through river, climb many mountains, and sometimes you happen to be lucky and you have some truck meanwhile. So you have to combine, you know, like, okay, you go by bus, and then you go by train, and then you go by hitchhiking, and then you go by horse car, and then all the time you go by buffalo cars, and then all the time you climb the mountains, and then all the time you walk through tunnels, duck through the mountain, all the time you swim through the river, and then all the time you happen to find some truck, you know. Truck that go around in the mountain, they want to carry rocks, and then if there's empty space behind, they let you come up.
1 rupee each person. 1 rupee is maybe about half of a cent in American money. Yeah, over there it's different, huh? Yeah, very cheap. Okay,
but the trucks
a very dangerous place to be on. Because there's no roof, nothing, and the truck is high, and the mountain road is very tricky. There are a lot of rocks that is hanging from the mountain on top of your head, so you have to watch out. Because if you stand up or you sit on the truck and your head a little bit above the roof, then the rock will hit you. So you always sit, hit, and bow, stand, you know, or, so your head always have a chance to exercise. Either turn left, turn right, turn to the front, or turn backward. It's up to you, up to the situation. But you have to be fast, or the mountain rock will send your head somewhere else. So very dangerous, but better than nothing. And then that, not to mention the way the truck drive, you know, because the mountain road is very windy like this, and then sometimes it's very stiff, you know, and the road is not paved. You stay on that just like you are riding on a horse, you know, it gallop, 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 gallop like this. And sometimes you have to stop because of landslide. The rock and the sand will run all over on your head, and then you have to stand up for your right and shake all the sand and, you know, get all the stone from your ears and then run. And then wait until the landslide over, or it never over. And then you have to run back again, find another road, and then run through another mountain, it's longer distance, and then walk again. Sometimes people die, the whole bus or the whole truck, because landslide come without warning. The whole mountain seems just like sliding down upon you and then send you ship rocketing to the pit under there, which sometimes many, many miles deep. You don't see the bottom, so you never see the bus again. So very dangerous, yeah? But it was exciting. I was young, so nothing really scares me. Now if you pay me $2 million, ask me go back, do the same journey again, I say, no, keep yours. Really, it was very, very challenging, you know? And then sometimes you walk through because you can't bring too many things with you, and you have your luggage, like a sleeping bag and some clothes, then you have to put it on your head with the plastic bag. You have to protect your clothes, because if you wear this one that you wear and you don't have another one to change immediately after you came out of the icy river, then you can become one with the river again, you know? You cold, you stiff, and then they throw you in the river, and then you become one. So that's the problem. See, you have to protect your clothes. You put it on your head, or even when you swim, you have to put it on your neck, you know, with the plastic bag on your back so you don't get it wet. At least you must have one pair of dry clothes to change immediately after you swim in the river, or walk through the river even, you see? So it's not that easy. The way I try to find the truth is hard way. But it was okay with me. What else would I do at that time? I had nothing else to do except to find the truth that I want to seek, see? So anyhow, finally we arrive, huh? And it was such a beautiful and romantic place, I told you. And then we stay there for maybe 2 weeks, huh? Until the initiation over. And still can stay on for a while. And I told you already, the Dalai Lama was always very kind to me, huh? Especially, every time I see me, he spotted me in the crowd. I say, "Ha! Hello, come here." And then he always gave me some of the precious medicine that he made himself. This medicine is specially Tibetan. I probably told you already. It's made of 72 different kind of precious stones and rare medical substance. It may be 100 over 100 substance together in one little tiny pill like this. And it's, you know, it comprised of a lot of precious stones, even like lapis lazuli and all that kind of thing, in powder. and all kind of very rare Tibetan mountain medicine plant herbs that combine together, and it's supposed to combat all kind of disease, make you live long life, and all kind of negative power will be defeated. A small pill like this, but very expensive, enough for free. But the Dalai Lama give me a handful all the time. I saw that I was the only one that he ever gave personally medicine like this. Every time he saw me, he gave me medicine. Yeah, I had some kind of scratch sometime because of climbing the mountain. And I have sometime insect bite, mosquito sometime, you know. And I didn't put any cream on my face, no makeup or nothing. And sometime I climb the mountain and I don't take care, you know, so sunburn and all that, the peeling. And scratch from the trees and kind of thorny bushes from my arms and faces and all that. So he probably think I desperately need some care. He was just a very kind person. But he was a very good human being, very gentle, very kind. That's why a lot of people like him, even though they are not his disciple, you know, Tibetan Buddhist. And that's why many people became Buddhist also, huh? And recite mantras and circumambulate with this. They have a kind of Dharma wheel, they call it. Every Tibetan have one. They always go around running either with the beads, prayer beads, or with the prayer wheel, you know. They turn around 24 hours. They say they're turning it because it's just like the rhythm of the universe, like the earth also turning, you know. So turning the wheel of the Dharma. There's a symbolic of the wheel of the Dharma, a teaching. Yeah? So everybody go around with that all the time. And some Western people, when they convert it into Buddhism, they also buy one. And everybody have a bowl like this, so you can drink tea. Everywhere you go as a monk, you must have a wooden bowl like that. Because everywhere you go, people will offer tea and eat, and you put it in the bowl. I don't eat that food because it's always non-vegetarian. Except when you became a monk, day you shave your head with your master, that's the day all the master and disciple eat vegetarian. They also know vegetarian, but they don't eat that all the time. Just that day. Yeah. Some of the Tibetan monks are vegetarian by occupation. For example, the oracle monk, he must, as a rule, be a vegetarian at all times. The oracle monk is a monk who has to predict the future and some kind of event by psychic power for the, you know, for the interest of the public. Yeah? Sometimes the Dalai Lama consulted them for some event. Sometimes they have to predict the future of the nation or what the outcome of a very strange event. You know, like predict the future and all that, huh? Like horoscope reading, but on a larger scale. And some other monks, they have like the weather forecast monk, like because he have to make the weather nice whenever the Dalai Lama or some high lama have to give lecture. Because they don't have a big place, so they give lecture in the open air. And a lot of people come like that. Then they have to make sure that during this 1 week or 2 weeks, the weather is tip-top condition every day. No raining allowed. So these are different kind of monks, you know. These weather monks, he has to sit in meditation all day, all night, and control the weather. Send all the rain, the hurricane, the typhoon back to somewhere else. Yeah, it's true. I had also the honor to study with some of them. And I told it to some of my disciples. And that's how it came, the story of making rain in San Jose last time. Yeah. Remember the story? Okay. I made joke with the man who tried to sell me the place in San Jose. And he believed in me. And that's why it rains. Maybe his belief was so strong. And after I come back to San Jose again later, and he showed me the lake that he asked me to migraine there before. He said, this is lake where the San Jose people, some of them drink, you know, and it's all empty. Can you migraine? I said, no, I'm not sure if I can, but I can find the rain god, you know, and send him back to work for you. Maybe it works. And I just said, maybe, huh? And then it really worked, you know. Immediately afterward, the rain fall, and then the half of the lake full. So when I came back to San Jose again, he showed me the place that I should buy. Every paper ready to sign, and he told me, only half, please fill another half too. I said, well, I don't know about that, let's see. But immediately it rained again later, and the whole leg full again. Remember last time? It was the first time I came to San Jose, and it was maybe first or second time, and it has been dry for 6 years, remember? And many cows dies, many animals dies, many farmers dies, many orchards die because no water. Orange and all that became very expensive at that time. Yeah? A lot of farmers bankrupt and many cows die. So that was the famous thing that my disciple made trouble for me. Yeah, because one of our sister told the one, the agency that want to sell the land for me, that, oh, my master, she can do anything. So the only thing that person want for me at that time was rain, because you don't have water there. But it happened that the mountain I bought is next to the lake also, and the lake normally have to be full for the resident around there to use, but it was all empty until the last drop already. You can see the whole leg dry. So he said, please feel it. I said, how, what? And he said, your disciple tell me you can do anything, anything. So this is nothing to you, right? Okay. Anyhow, I just study a lot of things, but I don't use them anymore because there's no need. You can make rain, that's for sure. That's no problem. You can stop the wind. Yeah, if you know how. If you can dig deep into the secret formula of the universe, and it's kind of science, it's like science, you know? It's just like before, we don't have wireless telephone, we don't have cordless mobile phone, now we do. If suppose 200 years ago, if you talk to some people long distance in a box like that, and the other one receive your voice just like next door in another box like this, you know, black and small in your hand, people would think you're a magician, right? But now it's ordinary. So some science about the universe have been lost to our knowledge, and we think it's superstition or impossible. Nothing is impossible, even flying through the air. Or live a few hundred years, or 1,000 years. Nothing is impossible. But what for do you want to? Did I tell you the story about the long-leaf lake water? No? Not even that?
No.
Didn't I all tell you, huh? Okay. Supposedly there was one lake in India, very deep, high in the Himalaya, with the elixir water. That has the ability to grant you long, long, long life. Okay? So, Alexander the Great, the one who conquered nearly the whole earth before, remember? Also want to have that kind of elixir water so he can live long, because there are a few more countries he didn't conquer yet. And he was getting old. So he went to the lake. It's very difficult to find that lake, you know, because not many people know. But then because of his power, you know, he has a lot of spies who has been able to find it for him. So finally, he was there in front of the lake, and he was about to drink it. And then suddenly there come a very husky voice and said, Your Majesty, don't drink it. No, no, actually, he didn't say like this. He said like this.
Your Majesty, don't drink it. He threw himself at the feet of the emperor. I said, please, Your Majesty, don't drink the water. It's dangerous. And the emperor, you know, Alexander the Great said, why? How can it be dangerous to me? Because the elixir will give me long life, and I will conquer the whole world, and I will conquer the moon, the sun, and the whole universe if I live long. What's the problem with you? Why you are obstructing me drinking this water? And the old man say,
look at me. I drank the water many hundred years ago. What will become of me now? You can see for yourself. I cannot die, and I can't live like this. The reason why I live on because I just want to keep this water. I want to stop anybody who come here and drink it.
So, Alexander the Great
got the message.
I was supposed to be a legion, you know, I don't know if it's true or not, I wasn't there. Obviously, Alexander the Great, emperor, did not drink it because he died, right?
Okay, the monks, the Tibetan monks with different magical power. Okay, so anyhow, so you know already, huh, about the rain monks and the, huh? Rain monks and the oracle, huh? The oracle monks supposed to be vegetarian, I'm just telling you, that's all, okay? Otherwise, most of all the monks are non-vegetarian, except the day they shave their head or their disciples shave their head to become monk. So I just drink tea. Even though it's very good for the cold climate, you know, like Himalaya, but it has a very strong, peculiar taste, and you have to be used to it. And then don't smell nothing anymore, just drink it. But you get used to it. It's quite tasty. It's just that you would probably never drink this kind of tea in your whole life if you don't meet Tibetan people. Because it's salty. It's not the ordinary tea that we drink, either plain or sugar, nah? Sweetened. This one is made with salt, so it's very salty. It's good for them. Because salt in such a region is like gold, you know that? So in Vietnam, when I was young, I know people used to trade, you know, some of the precious things from the mountain people with salt. Because the mountain people, they need salt so much. Because it's so hot, so high there, and if they don't have salt, they dehydrate somehow, you know? So they need it a lot. So the plain people in the city used to bring them salt, but take silver and precious stone, and anything from them they give. If you just make salt too valuable to them, that they have to beg you for it. Because the mountain folks are very innocent people, very pure. What else should I tell you? Oh, okay, I supposed to tell you about the initiation. Yeah. Got it. I got it, okay. Okay, because you'll be curious to know, huh? What is so precious about it? He only do that, if he does at all, once every 10 years. Yes, because it's such a big deal, such so much arrangement. They have to make a big tent to feed thousands of people. The Dalai Lama had to sit there for 10 days on a stretch, you know, with all the monks, and they have to dance also, you know, a very special mystical dance to invoke the spirits of the region and to make offering to the Buddha and to invoke all the protectors of the Dharma to come and protect them. So to keep the Maya away, so that the initiation will become successful. And all the, where the monk has to wave all his fan and, you know, walkie-talkie to talk to the rain god to stay away. Something like that.
So many things I have to do, and the oracle monks have to stay day and night at their beck and call just to predict if anything happened. And also the Dalai Lama security and all that, you know. Wow, it's a lot big arrangement. And he does that only once every 10 years. So a lot of people, you know, very lucky, they feel they can sit there and receive it. So every day before the initiation, the Dalai Lama recite a mantra and mudra and sutra and all that. And then the people will walk around this glass house where the Dalai Lama and the monks sit, you know, in circumambulation, they call it, huh? Circumambulate. A sign of respect. And sometimes they prostrate full length on the floor and make more dust. You know, and I had a lot of cough there going on with me, you know. And many men also cough, you know. And one time I put my mattress, you know, on the floor somewhere next to the house. They threw anything on the window. Sometimes they cook, you know, they peel some vegetable and throw it. When they do some vegetable and the rest left over, they throw it through the window and the cow passed by, we eat them. They walk everywhere free because nobody dare to eat them. They can feed them, they can worship them, but they cannot kill them. They will die naturally. People in India don't eat cow's meat. They believe it's holy. They revere the cows as a mother. So they don't ever kill cows. The Hindu people don't eat cow. Okay, during these 10 days before the initiation started, I was sitting next to the Dalai Lama and the monks outside. They make the glass door so that people can see them, but they are protected inside the glass, okay? And I sit in front of the glass, you know. Around the glass house, there is a kind of stage, you know? Just like when you make a tent, just like here, you make a stage like this, and they put a glass house in the middle of it. And people sit next to the glass house, on top of the stage. But only the Westerner, in one time, not all the time. And then there was the one Tibetan nun who sit there sometime in the daytime. I just sit there and meditate. And I do that every day, and no other people around. They allow the Westerner to sit there only in some occasion. But I don't know that. I thought the Westerner don't like to sit there every day because it's hot and they don't meditate anyhow. So I sat there and meditate. There's another Tibetan nun who sit there also after I sit. She also came up and sit. So a few days like that. But the next day I came, I saw that the bodyguard of the Dalai Lama just asked the nun to sit down on the floor like everybody else. No. Well, they don't sit on the floor, actually, they walk around on the floor. That's why I can't sit on the floor down there. So when I saw she's coming down, I also, you know, come down. You know? But then the Dalai Lama instructed his guard to ask me to come up. Yeah, invited me. So I was the only one who sit there during all this time. Yeah. And he liked me, I think. Yeah, sit next to him. Just separate by the glass door. Yeah, he instructed the bodyguard, so the bodyguard had to invite me up again. And I was very surprised, but I was in monk's robe. At that time I was in a Hindu monk's robe. Hindu's monk's robe is different from Tibetan. Hindu's monk's robe is either in saffron color, like yellow, like that, or in pink color, or in red color, or in white. When you see it, you know it's right away, you know, it's very special. But I just make a robe for myself from, you know, neck to toe, you cover, just slip like that, yeah. And I sit there every day and nobody dare to turn me out anymore until the time is up and over. Then everybody gone home. I was very privileged treated, I must say, you know. Like, give me a big tent in the Kumbh Mela alone, where all the monks have to sleep together, squeezing in another tent. Or like, let me sit next to the Dalai Lama all this time when nobody else sit, thing like that. I didn't ask for it. I thought nobody want to sit. I sit there because I meditate, you know. Where else do I sit? Except next to the monks and the holy people and support them, you know. Support mentally, huh? Like, we're doing it together. Yeah, you're doing great, you know, thing like that. And the initiation is about the explaining how to meditate, you know, and the meaning
of the initiation and the symbol that you have to remember during your contemplation. They will give you like a moon, silver disc with an Om word or some Indian word on it. You have to remember it, memorize it in your head, and then you have to visualize it when you meditate. Apart from that, there is another fresco, a poster, that you have to meditate upon, every detail. Now you know. And then you went home after the initiation, you tried to remember all the details, the silver disc and the word and all that, on top of your head, and you imagine another Buddha on your head, and you have to recite a special prayers. You call Guru Puja, the offering to the Guru, in the praise to the Guru. It goes something like, "Oh Master, you are the most compassionate, you are the most wise, you are the most omnipotent," thing like that. You would rescue my soul from the depths of my ignorance, bring me from the darkness to light, nourish my soul with all the wisdom and love, and things like that. Such a beautiful poetry. Even if you don't have to believe in Tibetan, or you don't have to believe in Buddhism or any kind of guru, it's a very beautiful essay to read to yourself. It's very nice. Yeah. It's longer than that. It's longer than that. And you should do this Guru Puja every morning or any evening. And then you do your meditation. It's a lot more, So you see, it depends on where you are and what you believe in, that you would judge a spiritual meaning or another, you see. You have to know. You just have to be open. You just have to be natural, spontaneous, in order to learn all these things without judgmental. I suppose people would think, "Oh, what kind of religion?" Or any, I don't know if they do like that. But I never thought like that. I was just too eager to learn about spiritual practice that I thought, maybe, why not? I try hard in case it is true. But it didn't help so much, so I said, forget it. Guan Yin method, best. Okay, If I remember anything else, I'll tell you another time. Okay? It's okay. Don't worry. I will fly over. It's late now. No, I don't need it. Thank you. It's late. Everybody go home. Okay? All right, bye. I promise you to come a few more days and I cannot keep. So okay, it's up to you. If you want to come, you come. But if you don't want to come, you don't come. Okay? I cannot promise I come or I don't come. If I come, you know I come. If I don't come, you know I don't come. Alright? Yes. Because I think enough, for a while. Okay? Okay. You're very welcome. Bye-bye. Have a good time at home and everywhere else every day. Okay? God bless.